Miss Rabbit has fainted. Miss Rabbit has fainted again.
What is going on with Hex over there at Alton Towers? Let's talk about it.
Now get ready. Here we go.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Ryan Ride Mechanic channel. How the heck are you doing today? Today's video, we're going to be talking about the ride Hex out of Alton Towers. That is not to get that ride confused with Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs at Disney World. Want to get that up front. These are two separate rides, okay? So, Hex at Alton Towers. It was closed for the 2023 season. Basically, it was closed down because they needed to do some extensive work on the ride. Now, for this video, I watched a lot of videos on the ride's operation. I watched a lot of behind-the-scenes videos. It's really cool that Alton Towers allows people to go behind the scenes and see that sort of stuff, which I wish more parks would do, but out here, at least in the U.S., they don't. So I was watching these videos, and I just noticed that a lot of the stuff on there was just really, really old. And I was just like, yeah, they probably had to shut that thing down to update a lot of the stuff. I would not be surprised at all if they replaced some of the hydraulic drive motors with maybe electric motors instead. The whole system was hydraulic. Vekoma likes to do hydraulics. That is a Vekoma madhouse. It's one of only a handful of them built. There's not too much attractions for these things, but they do produce a very interesting effect when done properly. So in case you're not familiar with the ride, let's look at it. Going for maximum grainy footage here. Sorry about that. So anyways, this is a artist rendering of the Hex ride. So what you see here is it looks like the inside of a castle. It's like a chamber, basically. You sit down here in the seats towards the bottom, and then it's called Hex because you're sitting in essentially a drum that's hexagon shaped, six sides, Hex. You can see those sides here. There's 1, 2, 3, 4, and then you can't see 5 and 6, which are down below it. But basically, you're sitting in a suspension swing inside that drum, and the swing itself is allowed to rotate on its axis this way while the drum rotates around that. So you get a really cool effect. It's a visually disorientating effect. For the seats, a lot of people think the seats have a lot of movement in them. Actually, they only have 15 degrees to either side. That's 30 degrees included angle. That's really not much, but when you use that along with the other effects, it's really cool because you can take those seats and rotate them to one side with the drum at the same time, so everything appears to be still, and then you can go back the other way. Well, it doesn't sound like much if you're not riding on it, but when your ears tell you that you're leaning back and then leaning forward again, but everything in the room hasn't changed orientations. Remember, it's locked in with the gondola at that point, or the swing, sorry. It produces a really cool effect that really messes your orientation up. And then once it starts getting going, the drum starts rotating on its own, despite what the swings are doing, or the swing is doing. So the drum's able to rotate around it and do some other cool stuff. They got a lot of lighting and effect in there. I could tell a lot of this 2023 downtime was probably due to refurbishing the control system for the ride. Not so much the ride itself, although they probably did work on that a little bit. But for the lighting and show package that this ride has together, this ride has an amazing show package. The queue line, its theming is just incredible all the way down. I would love to be able to go experience this in person one day. It just looks amazing. So then it opened up in 2024, and now it's went up and running, and just a couple of days after it went up and running, it went back down again. And it was like, oh no. Now, we flash forward a little bit. Actually, a couple of you out there, a couple of you out there have contacted me to make this video or ask at least what I thought was going on with it. Actually, right when I'm like, yeah, I'll do a video on that. Right when that happens, that's when they're like, hey, it's open again. Or at least it looks like it's open again. So I've done stuff like this before. I've worked on rides and it's had an extended downtime for something. Typically, we're waiting on a long lead time part to come in. And then it's like, that part comes in. Finally, it's maybe been a week or even a month down. That was a pretty extensive downtime, a month for a ride. These days, it seems like it's not that long because things take so long to get parts and pieces for these days. But the thing would sit down for like a month, and then we finally got the part in and put it in there. And then the next day, something else broke on it. And it's like, it went up and running for the day. Yay, that's good. And the next day, something completely different broke. And it's like, are you kidding me? And then it's like, oh, I gotta wait for that to come in now. And maybe that's another couple days of downtime. But it does that up and down game that none of us like, because it's like, is the ride up? Is it down? What's going on? Just tell us. So we don't have to speculate too much about this, because we got a little bit of video. Let's look at that. Okay, so this is the first thing we see here. What this is, it's kind of like a little hard to make out, especially if you don't know the ride. Like I had to watch a lot of videos to figure this stuff out, and like, okay, this is what's going on, to seem halfway intelligent. What's going on here is that this is one of the entry or exit doors right here, this door. And then up above it is the slider mechanism that electronically opens and closes the door to work the ride. Now, I heard someone there that works there was explaining how the ride operates, and they say that basically the start of the ride is to close this door. And it says once the door closes, the ride starts automatically. And I was thinking to myself, I'm like, that has to be a miscommunication there. Like, you don't just make a ride to where, like, once the door shuts, the ride starts. Like, that doesn't make sense at all. I think what they mean is, like, they hit the ride start button, and then once those doors shut, the ride starts. That's my interpretation of it. I might be wrong. And then on another video, they said, oh yeah, if the doors happen to shut while the team members are still, like, checking people or, like, helping people in and out or something like that, there is a marked off bench on the side where they can just go sit down while the ride runs its cycle and then wait to get out at the end. And I was like, holy crap, might be how the ride operates. That is crazy if that's the case. That might be one of those things, since you have an operator in a secluded area watching a lot of video monitors and stuff. I could see once the restraint signals are like, yes, we're good here. And once the seats are good and once everything else is good, I could see them losing track of the person that's going in and out of there momentarily and then maybe accidentally starting the ride. I would want to guard against that myself. I would have a person on the entrance and exit side of the drum, and I would both give them enable buttons. So basically, it would take three people to run the ride. You would need the master operator sitting in the booth watching the cameras, and then you would need a load and unload person, and then only once all three buttons are pushed at the same time, the ride starts. But that's me. That's just me. I'm kind of paranoid when it comes to that sort of stuff. Up here over the door is a slider mechanism that opens and closes it, like I said. And then what this is above that is the sheet metal panning that covers that stuff up. You could see over here on the left-hand side, this is the sheet metal that's undamaged. So it looks like what happened while this was running is that sheet metal came undone. It's probably held in with a handful of just, you know, like three or four little screws that keep it tied up against there. And the tolerance here is very tight. Let's see if we can forward this. Oh, that sounded like a fart. Oh, that's nasty. That might not have been the ride. That might have been somebody just farting inside the ride. We don't know at this point. Oh. Okay. Let's go back ahead. Wait a minute, go back. There we go. All right, so there's a lot of so's in this video. There's a lot of so's in every video. I say so a lot. So, anyways, this is that door that we were just looking at. Right here, the drum is out of position. The drum is actually sitting, instead of vertical when it loads and unloads, the drum is actually rotated right now. It's at about a 45-degree angle-ish. And you can kind of tell that by these were the planks on the wall, and they're running at a 45-ish angle up and down right here. So you see when the ride's being loaded and unloaded, that is the true level of the ride right there. It's like that. And this has already rotated past one way, and it's caught that sheet metal edge. It only takes just a hair. It caught that edge, and now it has started to deform that sheet metal up, and it probably started making some noise. And maybe that's when the ride operator stopped it, not sure. But if you look down here, it doesn't look like much. I mean, it looks like maybe 2 inches, maybe 5 centimeters, 50 millimeters, whatever you want to call it. Anyways, there's only about that much space between the side of the swing and the housing itself. Very tight, but yeah, just caught the sheet metal edge. Elevators do this occasionally too. There's a sheet metal flashing that goes right above the top and bottom of the doors, and every once in a while one of those will loosen up and come undone, and the elevator will catch it, and it really messes things up inside that elevator shaft. Okay, so here we are. They've stopped it. Go back to it here. See if we could. Okay, so they've stopped the ride here. For your orientation, right, everyone's typically sitting, like, I believe in a ride stop, this is probably going to be level. This would be the swing that they're sitting on. So this is going to be level, even if it wasn't. It's only 15 degrees one side or the other. So that's like like an office chair, like leaning back as far as you can. That's about 15 degrees, somewhere right around there. It's not much. But you can see there's that flashing on the wall right there. That is going to be the true level mark. So think about it from there to there, about 45 degrees. And then this is the set design that is normally sitting behind the seats when it's being loaded and unloaded. And then you could just normally see the top. Okay, so this is a good one. We got it later on with a flash, which is cool. So you try to look here. It's like, okay, what's going on? This is the center of the swing right here. So this is actually the support arm for the entire swing assembly. It's a think about like a top spin where it's got all the seats and then it has arms on the side that come up and attach. Same thing here. Instead of a gondola, you have a swing. That's what Vekoma calls it. And it comes out to the sides and goes up. And then that's where all of your exterior equipment and everything else comes in right there. But what we're looking at in this picture is right over here. This is the other side. This is the other door right here. So there's the orientation. And on the side that's all messed up, I believe it's 180 degrees off. So it's down below the floor, but it's to the other side of this picture. They're looking the other way right now. So it would be here on one side and there on the other side, if I have that right. I'm not too sure about that, but that makes sense with the other half of the video that we saw. They got the drum righted. Now the drum is sitting in its load-unload position where people can actually get in and out of the thing. Right here, this is the door that got messed up. And you can see the flashing, that sheet metal pan on top is just crumpled all up. But wait, there's more. There we go. It's pulled some electrical wiring out of there. There is a piece of flex conduit right there, and then some control wires have come up and got pulled out. So I'm not sure which part that's on. The way that conduit kind of angles down and in, that makes it look like it's on the swing side, not the drum side. So it's on the swing, and it's had some control wiring damaged in there, which I'm sure they wanted to really carefully open that up and get in there and make sure that everything was correct. They probably had to pull a handful of new cables, conduits, stuff like that onto the inside to actually make the repair. That is part of the reason why the ride was down for so long. It was down for a handful of days to make these repairs and to get that flashing fixed. And I'm sure they had to make a new flashing and put it back up there, which mean cutting, fabrication, theming, painting, whatever they needed to do. Assuming the part didn't come from Vekoma. I don't think that would come from Vekoma. That was just theming on the inside. So that was probably, in contract terms, that was supplied by others. Alton Towers being the others. Oh, I get a lot of work from Alton Towers these days. Man, keeping me making YouTube videos. All right, let's take a look at how this was constructed. I went around Tower Street, and there's another website. It looks like it's Tower Street and Tower Times is where I got these pictures from. You'd find them online, just Google Hex, and these pictures will pop right up. So basically, here's the ride during its construction phase. The big recess in the ground here is quite necessary because the drum is very large. It's a very large diameter, and it needs support bearings on both sides, and it needs plenty of room to turn. Now, this guy right here is standing in the center of the drum, which is, this is one side of the drum. And then in the middle right there is where you would put the big, big slewing ring inside there. You put that slewing ring inside there, and that allows the drum to rotate on top of that bearing. And then I believe the swing has a support boom that goes through that slewing ring to another drive device on the inside. Honestly, that one I'm not too sure of. I would use two hydraulic rams to move it 15 degrees and throttle the rams one way or another. That's me. I honestly don't know what Vekoma did to move the swing itself. Here's an interesting picture of during the construction. So what they've got here is that one wall that they were just building of the drum looks like it's been put up. And what you could see in this picture right here is that there is one side of the drum, the suspension arm, and there's the other side right here. Doesn't look like anything crazy out of the ordinary. There looks to be a small power package. Looks like a hydraulic unit sitting inside there, which makes sense. And then you would have this guy go through. The slewing ring would be mounted right to there. And then you probably have another set of suspension arms coming through on both sides, which is where the actual swing would mount inside of there. Looks really interesting to build one of these things. Okay, this one is from Tower Times now. This is someone poking over the fence somewhere, and they're like, they snapped a picture of it in construction. And here it looks most of the way completed. You can make out some things from this picture, not a whole lot, so try to zoom in appropriately. You can see this is the hex drum sitting there on both sides. And then around the one side over there, they have this nice, perfectly round ring sitting over there. That is the drive fin. It's a big metal plate that just sits there. And from the videos I've seen, they said it uses 8 hydraulic motors with pinch wheels, rubberized pinch wheels, basically to grab that drive ring and move it. So that's a lot of hydraulic motors. But when you're using rubber tires up against something like that, you have to account for a lot of slip, so you need much more power in this than you would just rotating it with some electric motors. And I think on this right here, I'm not too sure, but I think down here you can actually see the this part down here. I don't know if you can make that out. Looks like it's got some tarps over it, understandably so. But this would be the swing down here, or part of the swing starting to be constructed on the inside. That's the hard part about these things. You have to work from the outside in, and then in some cases from the inside out, just depending on which way you go. Like, everything you do is a pain in the butt for these rides. So it's like, oh, okay, we're going to build the hex tube, the drum. It's like, yeah, that's great. And then we're going to put the swing on the inside. It's like, well, wait, we got to do paneling. It's like, well, how are we going to do that? Well, you can rotate the drum and work on some paneling right there. But then when you do that, there's so much weight lopsided that the drum just wants to rotate back over, or you have to like chain it off every time you move it. That had to be very interesting to construct. I honestly don't know how, what the procedure would be for building that thing, because you have to kind of like do the left and right evenly. Then you could rotate it and then do left and right, then rotate it again, do left and right. But I mean, working on theming and lighting and everything else that all has to rotate and go through that, you got to remember everything on that drum, all that lighting and theatrics that they built on the inside, all of that has to go through slip rings. So anytime the, you know, past what they originally accounted for, if the lighting guys are like, yeah, we want to add another light right here on its own circuit, it's like, that's 2 to 3 more slip rings depending on what you're doing. I mean, it could be as little as 1 slip ring, but more than likely it's 2, possibly 3 slip rings for possibly every light. You would assume they would bus power inside and then do some fancy footwork like that to keep the number of slip rings down, onboard controllers and things like that, but you never know. This is a complex little setup here. Now, this is Hex Behind the Scenes on YouTube. This is by, Lincoln Dave. Had a really good video. There's actually a ton of these videos floating around out there. Again, Alton Towers isn't afraid to bring people back behind and say, hey, this is how we do stuff. It's really cool. And again, I applaud the park for doing stuff like that. But you could see in the background over there, you can see that large... Move this out of the way. You can see that large ring. Can I move this somewhere? Sorry if the playhead's getting in the way. That's the drive ring down there. And then at the bottom, these are the hydraulic motors down here. They work in pairs. So it's a left and a right. So you have in here, this would be 2 motors, and this would be 4 motors from what I understand. I've seen other pictures of that from a different angle. There is 2 motors right next to each other. It doesn't look like it in this picture, but they're there. So it'd be 2, 4, and then the other side would be 6 and 8. So all the torque and transition from this entire assembly is going through that ring down there at the end. There's also another really cool video I saw that was, it was where they had a video like this, but the audio was running on the inside, and then they took the inside footage of the ride and ran it in conjunction with this, so you can see it turn and then see what's happening on the inside too. That was pretty neat to see, but honestly, because it's more of an experience for your senses, it wasn't really something that you can really see a lot of in there. You could just see like, okay, they're turning versus the drum is turning versus which way they're turning. That's about it. So that's all I really have for this video. Basically, I mean, we got some messed up sheet metal, which pulled out some wires, and due to the construction of that whole drum assembly, I mean, everything on that ride has to be an absolute pain in the butt to work on, which I could actually see the downtime for, because to get to the back side of that, they might have had to get in there and take off scenic paneling. They might have had to rotate it around and take off a bunch of scenic paneling. They might have had to replace door slide components and things like that. And then I'm sure, as you could see by those construction videos, those construction pictures, there is not that much room between the drum and that cement wall. So, I mean, that stuff gets really hard to work on. I know I had a handful of people that I could count on for different physical abilities by that. Like, I had guys that they were younger kids, but they were able to get their arm way out there and behind stuff. It's like, I'm tall. I'm 6'2". So I have that same ability. I can get my arm way behind and around things where other mechanics would struggle like getting stuff. I could simply just reach around and do that with my fingers and get the thing threaded together or fixed up. So, and then I have other mechanics that were like really kind of wiry and thin, and they would be my guys that would fit in tight spots for me. So it's like, hey, we have that between that cement wall and the drum. It's like, chain the drum off and lock the right out. And then it's like, can you wedge yourself between there? And it's like, yep, I can get in there. And they would go in there and do that. I had guys specializing in, like, they like to climb. They just loved climbing stuff. So it's like, okay, we gave them the rides that you needed to do a lot of climbing on. So we tried to suit everyone's ability to the ride itself. But the good news is it seems like Hex is up and running. Honestly, it was just a loose sheet metal panel that caused all the damage. Now, the real fun starts for them. It's like, that would be my next thing. It's like, okay, who left the panel loose? Was it loose? Did we forget to put screws back in it on the morning inspection? Like, what happened? How did that get messed up? And how are we going to prevent doing that again? Yeah. That's a thing, because it's like the fallout behind the scenes is going to happen. It's like, all right, who messed that one up and who's going to redo it? Okay, I think that's good for this video. Thank you, everyone, for watching, like, and subscribing. I do appreciate that. If you haven't already, do subscribe downstairs. It does help me out, and I appreciate that. Go check out Alton Towers stuff. They do some really nice things there. Their theming is just on another level. I love that place for its theming. Man, they got some nice looking stuff out there. One day I'm going to make my way out there and I'm going to enjoy the heck out of that park, because that's such a nice place to go. I was listening to I hope I don't get this channel name wrong. I think it was Theme Park Worldwide. I was listening to them talk about doing a review, and they were talking about this, and they said, oh, the lighting on this looks kind of cheesy. And I'm thinking to myself, I'm like, oh, man, don't let Six Flags get a hold of it, because, man, we got just queue lines with no shade or no anything on them. Like, oof, it's nasty sometimes when you just make a ride with nothing else there. So, I love Alton Towers. I love what they do. Okay, I've gone on long enough. Like, subscribe, do all that stuff downstairs. I know I've said this 3 times already. What I haven't said is stay off the air gates.